So, sir, as we know regarding the arrhythmic disorders, the atrial fibrillation is, we can say, it's a commonest arrhythmic disorders, having the incidence rate of around 30 to 33%. But still, there is a debate on that, the whether this incidence rate is globally, which is around 1.8 to 2%, whether it's actual one or it may be it may be a fact number. So, what is your take on this particular aspect?
Yeah, actually, we did look at this, and as NOACs were coming, and also because of atrial fibrillation treatment was getting changed. When I was president of Indian Heart Rhythm Society about 2 years back, we did a very reasonably large longitudinal study. Most studies have been vertical so far, and that study showed that it included both private hospitals and public hospitals, rural, urban population, and just taking patients at point of care. We then followed them up. The follow-up was about 1 year, 98% follow-up. I think the manuscript will be out in one of the journals soon. And we were surprised to find that we have a double problem. We have age-related atrial fibrillation, which is the same as in the West. And surprisingly, although we are seeing less of new rheumatic fever patients, but patients with old rheumatic heart disease constituted close to 50% of the IHRS AFib registry even now. So which means we have as many patients and as the West, plus a huge population of atrial fibrillation due to valvular heart disease still, which is a little alarming, and we need to now work on how to be proactive in that. Okay. Which is surprising for us also, because we thought that rheumatic fever is coming down, so we'll have more age-related and not the rheumatic fever atrial fibrillation, but it's 49% or 49.8% rheumatic atrial fibrillation.
Definitely.
And that's a very well-conducted Indian Heart Rhythm Society registry, which I initiated when I was the president, and now the follow-up is there and the data is very, very strong.
Surely. So definitely, it's a very well said that in India, because of the rheumatic condition is so widely prevalent, so number of the valvular AF cases are much more as compared to the non-valvular cases.
It's equal now, it's almost equal.
Okay, now it's getting the almost it is equal. So now, there is also one concept regarding the screening of atrial fibrillation is going on. That how we can, that's earlier and on-time diagnosis of atrial fibrillation, can we go ahead? So, kind of the risk factors, if the patient having this kind of risk factors, then you will focus more that this patient should have a screening for the atrial fibrillation?
Yeah, see, a lot of patients are screened because they have some symptoms of palpitation, dyspnea. They come as a, honestly, I don't think we are screening all hypertensive or atrial fibrillation. But what's been even right now, after my talk at the CSI, I was emphasizing, and each talk I give on atrial fibrillation and SPAF, I emphasize, and it's amazing how people are trying to do it. Any patient who's had a CVA or TIA, now at least in our hospital and a lot of other hospitals, it's a protocol that they would be taken as cryptogenic CVA, and you start doing Holters, it's amazing how many of silent atrial fibrillation you pick up. So that's one area where I think that we've done a lot of progress. At least 30% of these so-called idiopathic or cryptogenic CVA or TAAs turn out to be atrial fibrillation. Yes. And then there's a huge hope with the NOACs and the anticoagulation to prevent the next stroke. Whereas if you say cryptogenic, you don't know the cause, so you're just leaving the patient on whatever it is.
Sure.
So that's a screening we've started. The rest, maybe there will be a time when we'll, honestly, of course, both ablation patients and population studies have shown that risk factor reduction plays a huge role in decreasing the incidence of atrial fibrillation. So that's known from, there was a time when it was, you know, some studies said yes, some studies said no, but now it's very clear that treating hypertension, dyslipidemia, and other coronary risk factors, diabetes, overweight, etc. If you meticulously treat, you don't have as much atrial fibrillation as a similar population which has not been treated. And also patients who had ablation for atrial fibrillation, the focus is even for by electrophysiologists on risk factor reduction.
Yes.
So that they don't have to ablate again.
Yes, perfect, sir. Regarding it, definitely for the control of the atrial fibrillation, the surgical intervention is also now happening, and the rate and rhythm control, some ablation kind of the procedures are also now very prevalent. But if we talk about the complication of prevention of complication in atrial fibrillation, the stroke is the number one complication. It's I think 4 to 5 times higher risk of stroke. And regarding the stroke prevention in AF, the number of the treatment has been so far so available from the vitamin K antagonist, then aspirin, and now newer generation also as well. So you, in your practice, definitely you must have passed through the all the cycle of the oral anticoagulants. So how do you have found this kind of the changes, and up to what level these changes are welcome?
See, as far as I do, of course, get filtered patients, honestly. So what I say may not, my practice may not reflect a general practice, but that will reflect over a period of time. As far as evidence goes, it's very clear that unless you have a SHAT score of 0 or 1, aspirin has no role.
Okay.
And nor does aspirin from clopidogrel. That's last choice only if no anticoagulation can be used. So 2 and above, you have to have rigorous anticoagulation being given. And when we did the survey, I started with a physician questionnaire, then there was an Indian survey, then the Asia Pacific Heart Rhythm Society did a survey. And it was amazing that Indian physicians were the most aware regarding the NOACs, but they used anticoagulation the least. Because one of the reasons was the risk of bleeding. Because if a patient has an AFib, that is his disease. If a patient has bleeding on anticoagulation, that's your those things. So there was this problem. But I think that's where the NOACs come in. Because you have patients who are from remote places, you have honestly not very great random standardized INR rates. Most of the do's and don'ts regarding food and drugs are same. But the food that, if you look at the food list, is Western food.
Yes.
We don't even know what palak does or, all this Indian food. And also in medicine, we don't know what the Indian systems of medicine, the herbal medicines that they take, Ayurveda, homeopathy, how they react with this warfarin. So we used to have a whole lot of problems with INRs going here and there. And to be honest, at least my patients are very happy when I tell them that now we have drugs where you don't have to be worried about eating at a wedding, for example. They go for a wedding, they don't know what they're waiting,
yes.
And next day the INR is high, or they come to hospital. I've had doctors coming to hospital with a bleed.
Sure.
So that's a big relief. The only thing that I think the awareness needs to go out more, and it will occur. It is a matter of time. Most of my new patients with atrial fibrillation, the NOACs are offered as upfront. The problem is patients on warfarin. If they are having labile INRs, then it's easy to convince them to. But if they are been having for years, they are happy with anticoagulant and the vitamin K antagonists, then you will need to discuss. Because I don't know whether these patients should be then taken off vitamin K and the NOAC should be given. So that's the only segment where I don't touch too much. But all new patients are offered, and also patients who are having problems with vitamin K antagonists are on NOACs.
So definitely this is a very practical point that you have raised, that vitamin K antagonist has this kind of the limitations, and NOACs can resolve these all the limitations regarding the INR monitoring and better compliance. Now this is just last question to you, sir. Regarding the NOACs, as of now the 3 NOACs are available in India, factor 10 inhibitors and direct thrombin inhibitor. So in your experience, how you have found that this drug should be given for such kind of a patient? So how you have choose the NOACs for treating the SPAF?
See, honestly, the first SPAF meeting with the NOACs was held in Brussels in Belgium, and I was there from that time onwards. So in India, honestly, dabigatran has the first mover advantage. So they have, this was the international SPAF, then we had the Asia Pacific SPAF, the Indian SPAF meetings. Most of them were evolving for about 2 years with dabigatran. And now we have all the 3. One is very sure that in terms of prevention of thrombotic stroke and prevention of positivity, it is just 150 milligram BD of dabigatran which has shown superiority. All the others are non-inferior. Whereas bleeding is a little less, with apixaban, rivaroxaban, and then dabigatran that way. So if I have a patient who has got a high SHAT score and a low has bleed score, then perhaps dabigatran and rivaroxaban or apixaban can be suggested. Some patients do want a single dose, and where rivaroxaban has an advantage. But on the other hand, if you are having a patient who has blood which is nearing 3, beyond 3, of course, you are very much concerned. Low SHAT score between 2 and 3 or 4, and has blood which is 2 or going to 3. In that case, of course, I go increasingly towards rivaroxaban and apixaban. And that's the way, I mean, simple to put it. Then, of course, if the patient has gastric irritation, then you can't give dabigatran, because the dabigatran induced gastritis is worse than what, I mean, the worst gastritis you can see. The same way, if none of these can be used for people who have renal dysfunction. And of course, valvular AFib is a big question mark with the realigned study acting. I think that was an unfortunate study.
Sure.
So that's the way you have to individualize, and you have no choice of all the three. And you look at what the patient is. I don't think there's a one drug fits all situation. So you need to read and tell other people who are using also, and say that
yes,
all three have their advantages and disadvantages, and can put it on the chart and see.
Definitely. So it's a very practical thing that you mentioned regarding the, as of now there is no head-to-head comparison between all three NOACs. So and even there, yeah, definitely in near or even in far future it will not be. So
registries and
yeah,
post marketing service
surveillance, that kind, that
otherwise you will not,
there is no actual clinical phase 3 trial will not having. So that's why, so there is a one NOAC will not be fitted for the, all the kind of patients. There you have to be customized, and based on the patient's requirement and the risk factors and condition, you have to choose the appropriate NOAC. So with this discussion, we are ending with this note that we are ending our discussion. So thanks a lot, Dr. Nair.